Thank you so much. Great to be back. This feels like a home away from home for us. We've been coming here how many years, Nancy?
34 years.
34 years, so no small reason to feel so familiar. Thank you. And thank you, Cynthia, and your team for making all of this possible, and we're thrilled to have a grand piano to play on, an upgrade from what was a very nice upright piano last year. So a new experience here, having piano for 2 years in a row now. If you've had a chance to look at your programs, you'll see we call it old friends and new acquaintances. And that kind of has a double meaning, because we're guessing you have not heard of Madeline Green. Has anybody heard of her? She's a wonderful composer. She was a wonderful composer and a real find, and we're interested in finding more of her music in the future. But in any event, we also have with us our guest artist, Soyeon Park, who's been playing with us since the spring. So she's kind of a new acquaintance, but not quite as new as she was last April when she first played with us. And we're thrilled to have her. And of course, Lisa Hansen, our flutist, regular member.
I'm one of the old ones.
And you may remember me, I'm Bob Lawrence. And eventually, I'll be playing violin. So we start with music of Francis Poulenc. The French critic Claude Rostand once referred to Poulenc as half monk, half naughty boy. I'll try and explain. Poulenc's father was a devout Roman Catholic. He was also a prosperous businessman with a very successful pharmaceutical company, which he expected young Francis to follow him into the business, but that didn't end up happening, thankfully, for posterity and music. And the mother was from a very worldly, arts-loving Parisian family. So he grew up in Paris, and initially his father forbid him from enrolling in music school. So he did manage some private lessons. But later on, he developed a very kind of humorous, what would later be considered kind of a lightweight style, and he fell under the tutelage of Eric Satie, who connected him with five other young composers to form a group called The Six. And their music was kind of a reaction to the French impressionism of Debussy and Ravel. It was an irreverent kind of approach inspired by Dadaism. And so that was his earlier years. But then later on, he took a turn towards religious music. His Gloria is played quite often, and it's quite beautiful. And you may hear a little bit of similarity. I don't know if anybody is familiar with this, one of the slow movements in the Gloria reminds me of the slow movement of the flute sonata you're about to hear. So, but this flute sonata in three movements you're going to hear reflects both sides, the monk and the naughty boy. And I'll leave it to you to decide what's what. I think it'll be pretty clear. Enjoy. Thank you. Have a set of pieces now with Zoe, our cellist, Zoe Hassman, and Heath Biggle. Jean Strickholm is the reason this group exists. She founded it in 1981, so it's been going for a little while. She was mere babe in those days.
She still is a babe.
Yeah. So you're going to have a very diverse set of pieces, and a warning about the pencil. Most of you will remember this piece as the Bach, the J.S. Bach Minuet in G. Recent scholarship has discovered that this piece from the notebook of Anna Magdalena Bach, who was Bach's second wife, was actually by Christian Petzold. I guess he farmed out the job to have a piece. But it's dee, da-da-da-da-dee, bum-bum-dee. And it also became very famous in the pop rock Lover's Concerto in the 1960s. We're dating ourselves a little bit here, but whatever. It is what it is. Yeah.
Right.
So in any event, enjoy. Zoe will tell you a little bit more about these lovely pieces, and take it away.
Thank you, Bob. Could not do anything without Bob. And as Bob has thanked everybody, I'd like to make a special personal thanks to Cynthia and Brandon and Joe and the team behind the cameras, and you in person and you out there. And thank my dear beloved partner in crime, Jean Strickholm. My mission, as well as Jean's, is to hopefully make you feel better, so when we're done, we hope you feel better. And through our music making this evening, Jean and I would like to fill you, all of your hearts, everybody's heart, with hope, with kindness, with peace, and humanity. I would like to start this diverse solo set with probably a 1 minute, don't put your alarms on, rendition of Amazing Grace for solo cello without Jean, and then she will join me.
Mm-hmm.
to have Jean join. Would you like to join me? Yes.
Oh, no.
No, you don't. See, that's what I'm saying. Over time, people start to say no. I'm teasing Jean. We would like to begin our duo concert with Jean playing Fauré's Berceuse, which is a lullaby. Aaron Copeland's Simple Gifts in 1 second. Chuck, getting ready? Ching-a-ring chaw. Ready, Miss Jean? Give me a second. Let me sit down. Let me get ready. Anybody here or out there know what a semi-opera is? Let me know. Just teasing. I always like to be educated, and I always need lots of education. Now, this lady, who wears so many hats I can't count that high to make this group possible, and then she sits down and plays, she is great at blues and jazz. So we're going to continue with Barron style, and you'll hear what I'm talking about.
Thank you.
new acquaintance part of our program. I'm going to read to you from Dr. Amanda Cook's flute blog, Between the Ledger Lines, because she has some interesting things to say about Madeline Dream. Multifaceted artist Madeline Dream, 1923 to 1977, was an English actress, mime, cartoonist, violinist, pianist, singer, and composer. She was a busy lady. She earned a violin scholarship to the junior department of the Royal College of Music, and she continued her studies there as a senior composition student of Ray Vaughan Williams and Gordon Jacob. In addition to composing concert pieces, Drink sustained her love of the theater by acting, singing, playing piano, and composing incidental music for the stage. She composed several of her chamber works, including the trio you're about to hear, which was originally for flute, oboe, and piano. So I'm taking on the role of oboe in this performance. She wrote it for her husband, Roger Lord, a professional oboist who played with the London Symphony. Flutist Peter Lloyd, Lord, and Andre Previn premiered the trio in the United States. Now this is interesting. You just heard the sonata for flute and piano of Francis Poulenc. Dring admired Poulenc, and her works often exhibit similarities in melodic structure and rhythmic wit. Poulenc's influence is clearly heard in the trio. I won't go on and on with this, but she even makes an allusion to the melodic simplicity of the second movement of the Dring is reminiscent of the second movement of the Poulenc flute sonata. So in any event, have an ear out for what you think may or may not be similarities between the music of Madeline Dream and Francis Poulenc. Thank you. Astonishing as he was writing mature pieces when he was a young teenager. For instance, his string octet for double string quartet, Midsummer Night's Dream, incidental music, written in his teens. What was interesting, the difference between him and Mozart was that Mozart wrote less mature pieces when he was younger and continued to go on this kind of curve and come up with his towering masterpieces as he matured. Mendelssohn started at an incredibly high level and stayed at that level. So different strokes for different composers, right? But in any event, son of Abraham Mendelssohn, a very successful banker, grandson of Moses Mendelssohn, a very eminent philosopher, born in Hamburg, but the family moved to Berlin when Mendelssohn was just 2 years old, and he was baptized Christian faith Protestant when he was 7 years old, but of course ethnically Jewish. So it was basically the family grew up without religion to speak of. Although he did write a Reformation symphony, number 5 after the Italian symphony later on, but he was so gifted in so many areas, a linguist. An avid reader, a painter, especially in watercolors, and a scholar. He reintroduced the music of Bach, J.S. Bach. It had been forgotten. He championed the music of Schubert, which had been forgotten, for instance, the great C major symphony. And he was also a fine conductor. He conducted the Leipzig Gewandhaus Orchestra for many, many years. So this particular piece has it all. I mean, it has gorgeous melodies. It has a scherzo, which is kind of the quintessential Mendelssohn scherzo, light, nimble, quick, silvery, and the slow movement is meltingly beautiful. The opening movement, Zoe gets reduced the opening theme on cello. It's a gorgeous theme. And then the last movement is kind of almost like a heavy-footed dance, somewhat obsessive, because it comes back again and again and again. And the piece is in D minor, but it ends triumphantly in D major. And listen carefully, because there is an allusion to the wedding march from Midsummer Night's Dream. Listen for that.